Good evening and welcome to INQ&A. The Inquirer Question and Answer program comes to you every Tuesday. We sit down with a leading newsmaker every week to discuss the issues of the day. And tonight, we have a very special guest indeed. You are listening to us on Radyo Inquirer 990. You are following us on Facebook Live. You are also subscribed through the different Inquirer social media platforms, including Twitter, Viber, FireChat, Line, and Kakao. We are also covered by Inquirer.net and by the Philippine Daily Inquirer. Last but not least, we are live on Inquirer 990 Digital Television. Good evening. My name is John Neri. I am Editor-in-Chief of Inquirer.net. And with me is my co-host, the Chief of Reporters of Inquirer.net, Christine Sabilio.
Thank you, John, and good evening to everyone watching us tonight. Before I give the floor to our guest, I have three things we would want you to know about her. The first one is she has a degree in European languages, and she majored in Spanish and French at UP Diliman. A second, she was a writer and senior editor for the Spanish news agency. And a third, she will soon apply, or perhaps applied already, for the AFP Reserve Force. Ladies and gentlemen, Congresswoman Geraldine Roman of Bataan. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, Christine. Good evening, John.
Good evening, Kong. Geraldine, thank you very much for making time for this. I know medyo ma-traffic coming all the way from the Batasan.
Mm-hmm. Oo nga po, napakahaba ng biyahe. It's more than an hour. You know, I live midway between Makati and the Batasan. So, mm-hmm. Medyo nagulat ako. At this time, pag medyo rush hour talagang... It tests your patience.
That's right. It is a test of faith also, yes. In the system. Kong Geraldine, maybe we can get right ahead to the issue. No, maybe for the next 20 or 25 minutes. Let's talk first about what everyone is talking about now: the anti-discrimination bill. So first, you sponsored it. I mean, there have been many other such bills, but then. Several months ago, in I think September, you sponsored, at the time, I think it was HB 267.
267,
that's
yes.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. Anti-discrimination
bill. On the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity, which we have renamed as the SOGI Equality Bill. For the knowledge of our listeners, SOGI means sexual orientation and gender identity expression. So, gusto namin ng isang titulo na medyo mas positibo at, you know, more optimistic. So we changed the name.
Okay, so instead of anti-discrimination, it's the SOGI Equality
Bill.
Yeah. On a positive, right. Ano naman.
Mas positibo yan. So, ang kwento niyan is that the idea was first hatched by Congresswoman Etta Rosales, you know, 17 years ago. Wow. And every year, yes. Lagi merong nagpapasa, nagfa-file ng anti-discrimination bill. And usually, hindi naman pumapasa kahit sa committee level. Mm-hmm. Laging nakaka-meet siya ng staunch opposition from the conservative sectors. Lagi nilang pinag-uusapan dyan yung bathroom issue. Mm-hmm. And yun na nga. And in this Congress, in the 17th Congress, of course, I refiled it together with my colleague Kakabagao, who is also an equality champ. I don't know, John and Christine, if you know the hashtag that we have coined, no? This hashtag equality champ to refer to the group of congressmen and congresswomen who support the anti-discrimination bill. So what's the difference? It's basically the same. We identify the different cases of discrimination at the workplace, in schools, in government agencies, also in the delivery of basic services, as well as access to commercial and public establishments. And after identifying these discriminatory acts, what we do is we penalize them. So, nakakatuwa naman ngayon, compared to the past, marami naman nagsusuporta.
Oo nga. Ma'am, so... We actually have questions about the substance of the of the bill, which is now part of a consolidated bill. But can we first talk about the legislative mill? No? I mean, so where is it now? It's now House Bill 4982.
Yes.
And what, there are like 120 or so?
No, actually there are 150. Kasi
150 yung count sponsors.
120 dun sa isang version. Mm-hmm. Tapos meron pang additional, ano? So sa consolidated is 150. That's more than one half plus one mm-hmm. of the total number of
wow.
lawmakers
oh, okay. that, so
that
to pass.
We are. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. And the nice thing is that this has been this bill has been identified as a priority measure mm-hmm. by the administration. President Duterte, mm-hmm. also the House leadership, mm-hmm. Speaker Pantaleon Alvarez. And nakakatuwa, 150 nagpirma bilang co-authors. So pasado na po siya sa committee level.
Mm-hmm.
Merong konting mga amendments.
Mm-hmm.
Tapos dumaan po sa Rules Committee.
Mm-hmm.
At nakaschedule na po siya this first half of March. For deliberations
for second reading
plenary
sa plenary
sa
yes,
plenary,
sa plenary.
Most optimistic ma'am, when do you think will it pass the house?
Mahirap kasi magsabi kasi sa March 15 magre-recess na kami.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
so palagi ko naman medyo mabilis na ito. Everybody is excited in mm-hmm. Congress. Sabi nila we want to, you know, it's about time.
Mm-hmm.
Parang yung naging attitude, I don't want to criticize, no, the lawmakers who belong to the previous Congresses, but now we seem to be open to the idea of that there should be equality
mm-hmm.
in society, and that the LGBT community exists, and maybe now the congressmen and congresswomen refuse to close their eyes to reality that stares them in the face. So ito mukhang papasa na ito.
Ma'am, I've heard both you know, veteran politicians and neophyte congressmen like Toff de Venecia point to you as instrumental in getting the support. They need it was something like they needed the example of you, your example, the first transgender politician in the House, and then they were able to generate this kind of support. Do you agree with that assessment?
Maybe, you know, maybe there's some truth to that.
Mm-hmm.
This was also relayed to me by my colleague Kaka Bagao, who mm-hmm. I consider to be the mind mm-hmm. behind this bill, you know, because she's a very staunch supporter mm-hmm. of equality. So ang sabi sa akin ni Kaka, alam mo Geraldine, ang pagkakaiba is because for the first time our colleagues are having a first-hand experience mm-hmm. of how it is to deal with somebody from the LGBT community, and mm-hmm. they have realized that you're no different from them mm-hmm. and that you are also a human being, and then that you have something to contribute given the right chances. If doors are not closed sa iyo, dapat ganun din sa rest of the LGBT community. So yung maybe the good experience, the positive relations that I have had with my colleagues should translate into positive relations also and acceptance of the entire LGBT community as a whole. So maybe yun ang pagkakaiba. Sabi mm-hmm. nga ni Kaka, kung ako yung sinasabi mong heart or yung mind, ikaw yung face at saka mm-hmm. yung heart nitong bill. Natutuwa naman ako and that I have been instrumental. But you know what? It's not about me. It's about equality mm-hmm. and human rights, and it's about the willingness of my colleagues to progress as a society and advance, you know. So the tribute should be to all of us equality champs, not just mm-hmm. to me or anyone in particular, you know. Mm-hmm. It's a common endeavor and passion that we share.
Mm-hmm.
Kung how big of a factor is the current administration as well? It has been certified as urgent. And correct me if I'm wrong, Davao City is a city that's, you know, has, I think, an ordinance protecting LGBT.
Palagay ko, kaya naman prioritize ng ating presidente itong anti-discrimination bill kasi meron na siyang positibong karanasan sa Davao City. Mm-hmm. You know, Davao City has one of the most advanced anti-discrimination ordinances in the country. I can cite other examples such as Naga, also Quezon City, and many municipalities, in fact. He wants to translate that to the whole country. At nakita naman niya, wala namang masamang you know, the sky did not fall or the economy did not collapse because you passed an ordinance, an anti-discrimination ordinance. And the same can be said about the Philippines as a whole. I want to point out that the mere fact that there are several municipalities, LGUs, local government units, that already have anti-discrimination ordinances mm-hmm. in place means that there is actually a need. Kasi marami ako narinig dyan, Christina, nang sasabi, eh bakit kailangan pa ng LGBT ng protection? Ano ba yan? Humingi ba kayo ng special rights or privileges? Mm-hmm. No. Ang hinihingi lang namin is equality. And mm-hmm. alam mo, special ang kaso ng mga LGBT. Mm-hmm. Sinasabi ng iba, hindi, kasama na yan sa mga men and women dahil according to the Bible, according to our laws, they're just men and women. That we do not negate. Mm-hmm. But you also have to recognize that sa mga sa hanay ng mga lalaki at babae, meron talagang mga tao na iba ang sexual orientation and gender mm-hmm. identity. Meron mm-hmm. mga lesbians, may mga gays, mga bisexuals, and transgenders. Mm-hmm. And to ignore this fact is parang nagpipikit-pikitan sa katotohanan. Mm-hmm. And it's unrealistic. And it's anti-progressive and I don't know, it's inhumane from my point of view.
Ma'am, do you have an estimate how many people in the Philippines would be affected positively by this
benefiting?
Mahirap mag-estimate, mm-hmm. Kuya John, kasi nga, marami pa rin hindi nag-out. Mm-hmm. There are many mm-hmm. people who would rather, you know, not talk about it, which is respectable. That is a person's individual mm-hmm. decision. But what comes to my mind, kung ang tao minsan napipilitang itago ang kanyang sexual orientation mm-hmm. or gender identity, that means that person perceives na makakarana siya ng discrimination at natatakot mm-hmm. siya that coming out would be taken against him or her.
Mm-hmm.
So, mahirap mag-estima. It's difficult to quantify kung ilan tao ang members mm-hmm. ng LGBT community.
Mm-hmm.
Eh, kasi nga, merong mga open, hindi pa open. Mm-hmm. Maybe for professional reasons, maybe for... But my dream is that one day, nobody will be scared of coming out and will just be who or she truly is
mm-hmm.
without fear of repercussions or retaliation or judgment. And pushing it further, my ultimate dream is the day will come when we don't have to talk about gender anymore. We'll just talk about human beings mm-hmm. and what we can offer to society mm-hmm. and we will respect one another, you know.
Maybe after a few more cycles of evolution.
Hopefully in my lifetime, I don't know.
Ma'am, I didn't ask that because I was assuming na if there are only a few people affected, it's not important. No, not at all. No, I wanted to maybe to bring
okay,
more people
so
to the
you're
discussion.
You're asking me if there are many cases of discrimination going on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's difficult to quantify.
I'm actually interested at least on what are the worst cases? Why do we need to protect
it's
the LGBT
hard to,
community?
For me, mm-hmm. kasi, you know, labeling them as the lesser of the evils mm-hmm. or you know the greater evil, mahirap yan. First of all, mahirap ma-quantify nga mm-hmm. yung cases of discrimination. Precisely because wala po tayong batas
mm-hmm.
na nagsasaad ng cases of discrimination based mm-hmm. on SOGI.
Mm-hmm.
So kung walang batas, paano mo maika-classify that as under, you know, cases mm-hmm. of discrimination based on SOGI? So, number two, yung tanong mo, ano ba ang pinakagrabe? Ako, kung papapiliin mo, personal opinion to, lahat ng kaso ng discrimination para sa akin are unacceptable. Kasi, mm-hmm. para bang hinahamak mo ang tao dahil siya ay ganito. But for me, yung pinakamas sa malalim na, may malalim na implications is when a person is discriminated against sa mga eskwelahan o sa trabaho.
Mm-hmm.
I say this because education is a basic right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you bear in mind a person's sexual orientation, gender identity, and the admission of students, parang namang hindi tama yun. It's hindi talaga tama because isipin ninyo, karapatan ng isang batang mag-aral, nagkataon mm-hmm. lamang na siya ay LGBT,
mm-hmm.
will you deny that child his basic right to education? Or will you subject that child to humiliation? Will you subject that child to judgment in mm-hmm. a school? Dahil siya ay member of the LGBT community. Doon naman sa workplace, lahat tayo kailangan natin maghanap buhay. Eh.
Mm-hmm.
ipagkait mo sa isang tao ang karapatan niyang maghanap buhay, o ang pagkakataon maghanap buhay, very cruel yan. Napaka-cruel. Parang you're marginalizing that person, you're condemning that person to a life of poverty.
Mm-hmm.
Mahirap na nga maging LGBT, kukundinahin mo pat gagawin mo pang LGBT and poor, mm-hmm. which is doubly difficult, mm-hmm. you know, more difficult than just being LGBT. So itong dalawang kaso na po, ito ang, para sa akin, yung matindi ang repercussions niya.
So ma'am, maybe we can go into the bill itself, no? So you are outlawing these discriminatory practices. For instance, tatanungin ka bago ka papasok, what is your sexual orientation? Dapat hindi kasama yun. Bawal na.
Bawal yan.
Kasama rin yun sa, like, you know, additional, like, opportunities for training, for instance,
yes,
di ba?
For promotion. Training. Mm-hmm. Lahat na mga possible developments or within a company, you know, mm-hmm. if your sexual orientation, gender identity is taken into consideration,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's absurd. You base promotions or demotions mm-hmm. or trainings on the performance of the individual, not on mm-hmm. his or her sexual orientation and gender identity. And the same thing for schools. So, yun po.
Ma'am, yung sa bill ninyo, there are 16 practices that are being outlawed, no? Aside from the ones that we've mentioned, what else?
Okay. Ito na uso to eh. Siyala niyo dyan sa mga bars, yan,
mm-hmm.
na very fashionable, mm-hmm. in vogue sila, no? Marami akong narinig na mga kaso, meron pa nga mga famous transgender mm-hmm. personalities, mga nanalo ng contest, ang gaganda mm-hmm. naman nila talaga, at mga decenting tao sila.
Mm-hmm.
So, pinagkait, they were not allowed to enter. Because they mm-hmm. said that these places had no cross-dresser dress, no cross-dressing mm-hmm. policy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? A transgender person dresses according to his or her
mm-hmm.
gender identity. Mm-hmm. These women were dressed as women because they feel like women. They actually look mm-hmm. like women. And you know, ano ba naman ang problema dun? Papasok sila sa isang bar just to have a good time like the rest of the human race.
Mm-hmm.
So why specifically do these bars have to develop or implement a no cross-dressing policy?
Mm-hmm.
Now another thing is kung gusto nila mag dress code, let's say bawal dyan yung nakachinelas,
mm-hmm.
bawal yung sleeveless, or bawal yung collarless shirts, that I can understand. Pero kung ang kanilang dress code is based dun sa sexual orientation and gender identity ng isang tao, ibang usapan na yan. Ibang usapan yan. That is pure discrimination.
Ma'am, yung sa other practices, no? Meron dito yung sa applying to a group, no? Refusing or revoking accreditation or formal recognition of any organization. So I'm assuming maybe like in a school, you have a club, you know,
yes. If you want
and the administration says no, you cannot have that
because it's LGBT based. Mm-hmm. No, you cannot do that.
Mm-hmm.
Or to cite a clearer example, remember what happened to Ladlad Party List?
Yeah, with Danton Rimoto. Yeah.
Yes, mm-hmm. and when the COMELEC denied mm-hmm. Accreditation and mm-hmm. recognition, dahil nga daw yung mga grounds on the basis of morality and mm-hmm. publicly accepted norms and standards. That decision was overturned by the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. You cannot do that. So what we want to avoid are these cases precisely. Kawawa naman, I hope hindi na mangyayari yan once this bill is passed into law.
Ma'am, we'll ask some questions. We have some questions already from social. I think the question of religion often comes into play. Let me ask a question from Ethan Tan Habok. Do you believe in the Christian God / entity based on the Bible? If yes, and I assume you also believe in the principles behind it, how can you be a transgender and the same thing a believer in the Christian God?
Yes, you know what? I believe in God. And I want to explain to all believers and all Christians that God created me this way. Surprise. Sometimes these things happen in nature. I did not choose to be this way. Mm-hmm. I was born this way with this mindset, with this psyche. If I had the choice, John, kung makakapili lang ako, Christine, hindi ko pipiliin maging transgender. And now we have a basic principle. You know, when a person is not given any choice, you cannot hold that person mm-hmm. morally accountable, or right. nor can you judge that person. Sisisihin mo ba ang isda mm-hmm. dahil marunong siyang lumangoy? Sisisihin mo ba ang aso kung marunong siyang tumahol? Yes, I do believe in a merciful and loving God. And I thank Him. I thank Him for creating me this way and allowing me the possibility to develop myself, to be true to myself, and become my best self and develop my full potential. Okay. Sabi ng iba, dapat daw, tinanggap ko daw kung anong binigay ng Diyos. Eh, bahagi nga na binigay mm-hmm. sa akin ng Diyos ang aking puso, mm-hmm. ang aking isip. Hindi lang naman what I have in between the legs eh. For me, that is the least of the problems. Ang mahirap, pwede mo baguhin ang katawan mo, pero ang puso mo, how you identify mm-hmm. yourself, hindi mo mababago yan. Madalas tinatanong sa akin, oh, kailan ka nagdesisyon maging babae? Hindi ako nagdesisyon maging babae. Oh, kailan mo nalaman naging babae ka? Well, ang sagot ko, Christine, John, kung kailan nyo nalaman na kayo ay lalaki at babae, more or less at the same time, pinili mm-hmm. nyo ba yan? Hindi. Ganun lang ang pag-iisip nyo. Now, ang aking decision to undergo gender confirmation surgery, mm-hmm. that's what we call it, mm-hmm. is also based on my belief that God looks beyond what is physical. He looks at the heart. Mm-hmm. So, bago ako nagdesisyon na magpa-opera, ako, nagkonsulta pa po ako sa mga Jesuits mm-hmm. Ateneo where mm-hmm. I studied. And I spoke to a person who saw me through the turmoil. Na ginabayan niya ako nung ako'y binubuli, mm-hmm. nung panahon na hirap na hirap ako dahil ang puso at isipan ko ay babae, pero ang katawan ko, you know, puberty yan, adolescence, mm-hmm. nagde-develop in the opposite direction. Mm-hmm. Imagine mo, John, kung ikaw bukas, ganyan mm-hmm. ang isip mo, ang puso mo, lalaki, mm-hmm. ang isip mo, lalaki, tapos gumising kang katawan mo, babae. Mm-hmm. At ikaw, Christine, ganon. Babae ka, sa isip mo, puso mo, gigising ka, ang katawan mo, lalaki. Nakakabaliw yun. And I had to deal with it. How did I deal with it? I prayed a lot. I asked God, and I tried to discern what His will was in my life. Mm-hmm. But anyway, fast forward, nung nag-desisyon ako way back in 1994 para magpa-opera, nagkonsulta ako sa Mesuita. Ito ang sabi nila sa akin, Geraldine, the body is just a shell. At wag na sana mag-argue yung mga fundamentalists. Sabihin, no, the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. I agree with you. Mm-hmm. I agree with you. But what these Jesuits meant was that more important than the body is God, it is one's heart, and that is where God looks at, you know. Mm-hmm. So the body is just a shell. So if you feel that modifying the outside or the shell, you can become a more loving, more generous, and happier person, then go ahead. Because God looks inside your heart, not at what you have in between your legs. And I am happy to say that because of my decision to undergo gender confirmation surgery, which for me was a life-saving mm-hmm. procedure. Alam nyo kung wala palang ganito nung araw at pinanganak ako sa 19th century, wala pang siyensya, wala pang teknolohiya na magpapermit sa akin magpalit ng physical ng kasarian ko. Mm-hmm. Baka naloka ako, baka ako nag-suicide. I want to inform our listeners that suicide rate among transgender people is very high. Napakahirap ng sitwasyon. And my heart goes out sa mga tao na hindi nakakamit ng acceptance as I have mm-hmm. o kaya walang financial resources to finance an operation, and they have to cope with this condition in the best way they can. Tapos sasabayan pa ng paghuhusga ng mga so-called men of God. Mga kapatid, ang kilala ko pong Diyos ng mga Kristiyano, isang Diyos na nagmamahal, umuunawa sa kanyang mga nilalang. At alam ko, sa kaibuturan ng aking puso na nauunawaan ng Panginoon, ang aking mga desisyon, ang aking pinaglalaban. Malay nyo, kaya ginawa ng Diyos ang LGBT community para subukan kung paano kayong magtatrato sa amin. Malay nyo, isang malaking pagsubok rin to. Sabi nga ni Pope Francis, you know what, don't huwag kayo masyadong dekahon. God is greater than the Bible. As a Catholic, I don't even believe in the literal interpretation of the Bible. Revelation is continuous. Don't stop yourselves from, don't stop the Holy Spirit from surprising you.
Mm-hmm.
We have to maintain an open mind. But the bottom line is this. If you do not have love, mercy, and compassion in your heart, one's knowledge of the Bible, kahit memorizing mo yan from Genesis to Revelations,
mm-hmm.
your knowledge is useless. Dun tayo sa essence, yung pinakamahalagang bagay. So that is how I reconcile being Catholic and being transgender. I'm just being true to myself and true to what God has given me. But I have had to survive and to become my best self, which I think is what God wants for me.
Well, maybe it's not a question of reconciliation, but I mean, it seems to me it's the direct consequence of who you are. I mean, that's why you're doing this.
Kasabi ko nga, it's the direct consequence of who I am. Kung lumangoy ang isda, what can you expect? Eh, talagang lalangoy yan. Kung tatahol ang aso, talagang tatahol yan. It's part of who we are. We did not choose. Kaya, utang na loob. Spare us the Bible verses. Kasi, hindi naman applicable lahat. Yun nga, sinasabi ko rin, Kuya John, Christine, you know what? Ang gusto ng iba, ibase lahat sa Bible. Which for me is absurd. Kasi dun mismo sa Bible, meron niyang clause na sinasabi, not everything that Jesus did and said was registered in the Bible. If they were registered, not the entire world would be enough to carry the weight of the books that would have to be written. Sabihin ko doon, malay niyo, nagsabi salita si Jesus, I'm sure meron na rin transgender nung panahon, malay mo, nagpakita siya ng awa at pag-uunawa. Malay niyo. Ang sinasabi ko rin po, you know, we also have to take the Bible from its within its cultural and historical context. It's not just, okay, I read this verse, this is what it says there. No. We have to bear in mind that meron niyang history and cultural context. And, you know, it was written thousands of years ago. Alam niyo, ang phenomenon ng transgenderism has only been recently understood.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm talking from a medical and psychological point of view.
Mm-hmm.
So, paano mo naman, how will you expect the Bible to make declarations about transgenderism when at that time it was not understood? You know, it's like expecting the Bible to make pronouncements, moral pronouncements, on genetic engineering
mm-hmm.
or astronomical physics. I mean, it's absurd, diba? Mm-hmm. We draw lessons from the Bible, and they are very important lessons. Pero alam nyo, ito nga mga nagsasabi, meron pa nga nagko-quote na, dapat ang lalaki bihis babae, lalaki at vice versa, no? Eh, just ko, Old Testament yun, and nowadays, you can't even define kung ano yung male fashion or female fashion. Tsaka, you know, tanong ko rin dun sa mga nagsasite ng Bible verses, kayo ba kumakain ng mga walang kaliskis na seafoods? Ayan, sinasite din yan sa Old Testament. Kaya nga, as a Christian, I'm aware na sa New Testament, ang sabi ni Jesus, what defiles a man or a person is not what is on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
It is what comes out from the heart. Yan ang sinasabi ko nga na ang Diyos tumitingin sa puso. So all of these are externals na hindi naman ganun kahalaga. So we should not place excessive importance on that.
Wow. Ma'am, we're going to take a break. But before that, we have viewers watching, saying hi from the Republic of Iloilo. Can you say hi to them?
Magandang gabi po sa mga Ilonggo. Alam nyo, tuwan-tuwa ako pin nakakasama ko yung mga colleagues ko sa Congress na mga Ilonggo. Talaga natutuwa ako sa inyong ang accent. Very sweet,
mm-hmm.
very cariñoso. Sana makabisita po ako rin sa inyo sa Iloilo.
Okay. To everyone watching us tonight, you're still with INQ&A with Bataan Representative Geraldine Roman. We'll be back after a minute.
Balita, showbiz, sports, opinion, serbisyo publiko.
Plus, The Heirs, Descendants of the Sun, Meteor Garden, F4, Voice Over Flowers at iba pa. Sa mga teenagers, libre din ang K-pop at mga variety shows. Panoorin ng libre, high definition, sa Wi-Fi o mobile data. O i-download ng libre anytime, anywhere, always. Hanapin ang View app sa Google Play Store at sa App Store kung iPad o iPhone at install sa inyong device. Handog ito sa inyo ng Inquirer Mega Mobile at ng PCCW View.
Good evening, and you're back on INQ&A with Bataan Representative Geraldine Roman. Ma'am, a few more questions about the anti-discrimination bill. This is from Sam, at I am Bantam Sam. Cute nung handle niya. On Twitter, if the ADB gets passed, what will your next step be in your fight for equality, especially for the LGBT community?
There are initiatives in Congress, mainly on the part of our Speaker, Pantaleon Alvarez. He wants to find a formula to have same-sex or otherwise mm-hmm. relations recognized legally, mm-hmm. but outside marriage.
Like a civil union.
A civil partnership or mm-hmm. union. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we're parang mas pabor siya doon sa civil partnership. And of course, I support that. Kasi I cannot be a hypocrite, John and mm-hmm. Christine. If I say I believe in equality, but I would tell my friends who are LGBT na, oh, I believe in equality, but your relationship cannot be legally recognized kasi same-sex kayo. Mm. Obvious naman na discrimination yan eh. I want to reassure our listeners na hindi to marriage. Mm-hmm. Marriage is an institution. It's a sacrament for many religions. It has mm-hmm. religious connotations. So we want to respect that. But what we want to talk about are civil rights. Civil rights that are guaranteed under the Constitution, where the tenet of equality is enshrined. Yan ang lagi kong sinasabi. Mm-hmm. Nasa preamble yung equality. So, paano magkakaroon ng equality kung mamimili lang tayo? Ano to? Selective equality.
What does that entail, civil union? What rights will the participants get out of that?
It's hard to pinpoint at this point kasi pinag-aaralan pa rin ng legal team ng ating speaker. But if it will definitely include, syempre, yung inheritance, mm-hmm. tapos yung property rights, you know, kung anong regime ang fa-follow natin, whether conjugal or separation. Mm-hmm. We're also thinking about the right to decide in case a partner, let's say, gets sick, mm-hmm. tapos na-coma siya, mm-hmm. sino magde-desisyon tungkol dun sa future ng partner na yun, ano? So, ang gusto rin ng speaker, hindi yung limited sa same sex. Kasi, mm-hmm. alam nyo, marami rin mga heterosexual relations na hindi sila naniniwala sa marriage, eh. Mm-hmm. They want to avail mm-hmm. the civil rights. So, maaaring ito rin ang formula para dito, no? This formula exists already in Europe and the United States. Parang dun sa ibang mga bansang ito, it's parang legal recognition ng mga nag-live-in na.
And for children also.
Possibly other, yeah. For children. Pero hindi ko pa nakikita kasi yung final version itong measure na to. No?
Ma'am, I'll get back to Speaker Alvarez in a few minutes. But I want to ask you, have you talked to your counterpart in the Senate? So Risa Ontiveros is working on Senate Bill 1271. Have you been talking to your counterparts?
To tell you the truth, hindi ganong kadalas. Not as often as I would have wanted to. Mm-hmm. You know, we met early on, immediately after the SONA, mm-hmm. to plan nga itong anti-discrimination bill. And since then, you know, sa balita lang kami nagkakaroon ng communication. But I know that she's doing a great job. Mm-hmm. And there are many equality champs in the Senate mm-hmm. as well. So,
although sa balita ngayon, it's the ones who are not in favor, like Senators Pacquiao and Soto.
Oh, I want to point out, I was in an interview the other day, mm-hmm. no, sa program ni Cara David at saka ni Howie Severino, in News mm-hmm. to Go.
Sure.
Nag-phone patch si Senator Tito Soto, and he clearly stated that he's not against the anti-discrimination bill. He just wants it fine-tuned, you know, mm-hmm. to prevent abuse on the part of people who might want to abuse the law to get mm-hmm. away with their deeds, no?
Mm-hmm.
And
I find that hard to imagine. I mean, how can you abuse the anti-discrimination bill?
To get benefits.
Is particularly concerned. Baka daw dun sa comfort room na meron magpapanggap na transgender para ma-sexually molest ang mga women.
Mm-hmm. But that's not even in your bill,
it's
right?
It's not even in our bill. You know, we do not require commercial establishments to build a separate bathroom. Wala. It's not dealt with mm-hmm. in our bill in the lower house in Congress.
Ma'am, a question from Erica Faye Fabian. What's your message to the Pinoy youth?
My message is this. I'm very optimistic. Kasi sa pag, you know, I've been traveling around the country. I've been receiving so many invitations from universities, from schools, from the youth in general. I'm pleasantly surprised to discover that ang mga millennials, ang mga kabataan ay bukas ng pag-iisip.
Mm-hmm.
At natutuwa ako, nagagalit sila sa diskriminasyon. Alam nila na ang pinaglalaban natin ay equality under the law. Equality under the law and human rights. And they have big hearts that are compassionate.
Mm-hmm.
Kasi nga, umuunawa sila sa mga taong medyo iba and mga tao na traditionally sa ating lipunan ay inaapi, pinagtatawanan, hinahamak. So, pag meron kang ganoong kabataan, edi maganda ang ating kinabukasan. Kasi ang gusto ko sana magkaroon tayo ng isang bagong Pilipinas where everyone has a place, where everyone is made to feel welcome and where everyone is allowed to be his or her best self and to develop his or her full potential. And I think the youth share the same sentiments and that makes me happy. Kayo po nagbibigay ng lakas na loob sa akin upang ipagpatuloy itong paglaban para sa equality despite the occasional bashing that I may receive.
How do you handle that?
Yung mga bashing, alam mo, ang sabi ko nga, no, nangangampanya ako yung bashing na tinatawag kong bakla, kahit anong gawin mo, lalaki ka pa rin. Okay yan, ma-handle ko yan because I know my truth.
Mm-hmm.
Itong nangungusap sa akin ng aking puso, ang aking isipan. Pero nasasaktan ako nung hinuhusgahan ng relasyon ko sa Diyos because mahalaga po para sa akin ang aking pananampalatay at relasyon mm-hmm. ko sa Diyos. And I have tried my best within my modest means, within my limitations, to develop that relationship and become a good person,
mm-hmm.
even in my dealings with my fellow men and fellow women. So for people who do not know me, who do not know my personal circumstances, alam nyo ba ang pinagdaanan ko? Alam nyo ba ang pinagdadaanan ng maraming LGBT na hindi naman nila pinili maging ganito. Alam nyo ba? Kung hindi nyo alam, how can you? How can you even think of judging us? Lalo na ang aming relasyon sa Diyos. How can you? So how do I handle it? I know that I'm fighting the good fight.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I'm fighting for something na matagal nang kinakailangan ng ating lipunan. So, when you know that you're fighting the good fight, the suffering that you may encounter, you may undergo, just takes the background, no? And
mm-hmm.
you focus on your goal. And when you reach that goal, masarap ang pakiramdam. Masarap ang pakiramdam. Parang, despite all odds, and I believe that we're also being guided by God. Honestly, sana wag yung husgahan to, yung sinasabi ko. Iyan ang talagang pakiramdam ko eh.
Mm-hmm.
And tinutungo tayo doon and thank God.
Kong, what is just that I mentioned earlier? You're planning to join the AFP Reserved Force. What is the status of that and what pushed you to say that or to plan to do that?
Well, I am in the process of applying for this and compiling all of the requirements, to try to meet, you know, the requirements. What motivated me to join the AFP Reserve Force is a family tradition. Ginawa na yan ng father ko, ginawa na rin ng mga pinsang kong nasa public service sa bataan. At ang sabi nila sa akin, it's because if you are a reserve officer, pagdating ng mga sakuna, ng mga kalamidad, ng mga disaster, eh malaki ang naitutulong ng army. Kaya nga gusto ko sa army.
Mm-hmm.
But I also want to send a message, no? Pangalawang dahilan ko, na kahit mga taong katulad ko ay nagmamahal din sa ating bayan, sa ating bansa. And we should not be scared. Kung gusto mo, palagay mo na kaya mo maglingkod sa ating bansa sa pamamagitan ng ating armed forces, go ahead. Sabi nga ng recently merong positive development sa AFP. Nagsabi ang commander yung head ng AFP na tatanggapin nila ang members of the LGBT community, which is a positive development. Kasi ganun din naman nangyayari sa Estados Unidos, sa ibang bansa, hindi na issue yung ganyan.
Well, I'm glad you brought this up because the downside to making history as the first transgender member of Congress is that you might be typecast in a certain way. So it I'm glad that you brought this up. And you said something earlier to us, no, while preparing for the show that really excited us, that you have another pet bill about the National Scholarship Agency, which I think is a terrific idea. Can you talk to us about that?
Oo nga, yun ang sinasabi ng mga opponents ko dati. Naku, huwag yung boto yun si Geraldine kasi maging one issue yan. Marami akong panukalang batas na na-file, more than 40 na sa ating kongreso. One of which is the National Scholarship Agency Act. Ang layunin po ng panukalang batas na ito ay magtatag ng isang ahensya ng pamahalaan kung saan isa-centralize natin ang lahat ng scholarships, whether primary, secondary, tertiary, postgraduate, foreign grants, scholarship loans. Basta may kinalaman po sa scholarships, gusto ko sana itong ahensya lamang na ito na mag-maintain ng database, magpa-process, at magdi-disperse ng mga funds. And the reason why is ganito. Under the present setup, pag ang isang poor but deserving estudyante gustong mag-aral, saan siya pupunta? Merong iba nagpupunta sa CHED, sa DSWD, sa DepEd, meron iba sa congressman, sa congresswoman, sa LGU, sa mayor, sa governor. Naguguluhan siya. So, palagay ko dapat, napakalinaw isang ahensya, alam ng lahat kung saan pupunta. Pangalawa, it's going to be a more efficient arrangement because when you have an interagency endeavor, maraming ahensya ang nakikialam dyan.
Mm-hmm.
Kanya-kanyang ahensya, ang bawat ahensya ay may kanya-kanyang prioridad at merong, you know, depending on its priorities, it will spend its budget. So, parang magulo, you'll never get your act right. So, yun po ang dahilan kung bakit nag-isip po ako ng National Scholarship Agency kasi nag-exist na rin po yan sa Europe.
I have a feeling though that some of your fellow congressmen might not like the idea.
Yeah.
Why not? They can inject funds and then credit would be given to where credit it is due. Kaya what we're trying to do is to make the process more efficient to prevent duplicity.
So, for instance, you have two students. One is studying in UP Diliman, let's say, and the other one is studying in another state university, and they're both applying to, let's say, you know, Columbia University or whatever. Right now, parang the chances are that the odds will favor the one from UP. He has more access to, you know, that the kind of grants that will bring him to New York and so on. Ito bang sa
equalizer.
Now, you know what? The final decision whether to accept that student or not, of course, is
with the
Columbia University in this example. No, but what we can do is basically to guide the students how to avail of that scholarship,
mm-hmm.
and
to give them the best, both of them, the best chance.
The best chances, mm-hmm. within their own limitations, because talaga naman, let's face it, merong mas matalino, may hindi, and talagang ganon. That's life. Mm-hmm. But at least they should be given an option, and they should be fully informed of what their options are. Yun yun ang aking layunin, yes.
What do you think is the timetable for this?
Medyo matagal eh, kasi maraming other priority bills din sa Committee on Higher Education. So magpo-form kami ng technical working group.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Have you heard from DepEd or from CHED?
Humingi ako actually ng statement from DepEd once when we met with Secretary Briones, but mm-hmm. I haven't gotten their reply yet. So I'm still awaiting mm-hmm. the reply. But marami naman nagsasabi sa aking mga colleague ko na yes, maganda tong ideya na to. Now, meron tayong isang batas na tinatawag na UNIFAST law. But this only covers tertiary,
mm-hmm.
tertiary education. Tapos, ang pinagtatrabaho niya dito yung CHED, eh hindi naman talaga mandato ng CHED nagkano ng scholarship. CHED mm-hmm. is more of a policy-making body rather than an agency that processes scholarships.
Kong, I have a question from Twitter from Ambi Social. What is your stand on federalism and how will it benefit regional governments down the line? Especially, I guess you have experience in LGU with your family.
Yes. You know, my experience with federalism was more direct. When I was studying and living in Spain,
mm-hmm.
Spain has a federalist system, and many European governments have a federalist system. Maganda naman. Kaya nga lang, I remember once binisita ko ng father ko, the late Congressman Tony Roman, way back 2002, he visited his counterparts in the Spanish Congress, mm-hmm. Congreso de los Diputados. So merong tinanong niya, way back 2002, at that time, nagkakaroon tayo ng mga secessionist moves mm-hmm. sa South, no?
Mm-hmm.
So sabi niya ganun, what do you think if we apply the federalist system in the Philippines? So, tinanong siya ng mga counterparts niya, sabi niya ganun, kayo ba, you have more or less a homogeneous culture?
Mm-hmm.
Or are you more regional na? There are cultural differences.
Mm-hmm.
Tapos, aside from that, is your economy more or less equitably and evenly distributed? And then tinanong din niya, do you have more or less a linguistic unity in mm-hmm. the country, also geographic?
Mm-hmm.
Para nakikinikinitan niyo na mga sagot, diba?
Okay. But,
number one, okay, mas malakas bang regionalism kasi mm-hmm. yung sense of being Filipino. Number two, linguistically, where many languages, I'm not talking about dialects, talking about languages. Kasi ang dialect yung Bulakenyo Tagalog, mm-hmm. Batangas Tagalog, but they're all Tagalog. We're mm-hmm. talking about Ilocano, Kapampangan, Tagalog, mm-hmm. Ilonggo, Cebuano,
mm-hmm.
so many languages. And then, pangatlo, geographically speaking, we are 7,107 islands. And of course, you know that there are the poorer and richer
mm-hmm.
regions.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm, okay, mga sagot siya, no, medyo discouraging. So, ang trick dito, para sa lahat ng mga kasamahan ko sa Kongreso at mga magda-draft nitong batas at saka magbabago ng ating constitution, is maghanap tayo ng eksaktong formula that will address yung ating circumstances, mm-hmm. peculiarities, and nuances dito sa Pilipinas. So, kailangan maging realistic tayo. Alamin natin na talagang ganito ang sitwasyon natin, kakaiba. So maghanap tayo ng formula na mag-address nito. Ang benepisyo ng federismo ay ito. Mas mabilis ang delivery ng services, mas mabilis ang decision making process. Pero ako itong isang bagay lang ang ginagarantihan ko po sa inyong lahat. Pag binago po natin ang saligang batas, mag-i-introduce po ako ng isang klausula, isang clause that will guarantee our territorial integrity. So following the example of the Spanish Constitution of 1978, kaya yung mga separatists nila dun sa Northern Spain, sa Basque region at saka sa Catalonia, walang magawa kasi meron silang parang safety clause na nagsasaad na any move such as referendums or whatever, in the direction of self-determination or separation from the rest of the state is not allowed.
Okay. That's very interesting. Yeah.
Ma'am, we have more viewers watching from Singapore. Let's say hi.
Hello, kumusta po kayo sa Singapore? Alam ko ang layo-layo nyo. Mabuhay po kayo.
Ma'am, if you can just give a quick answer, then we'll start with our little quiz. I did say I'd go back to Speaker Alvarez. I am struck by the fact that on certain, he has thrown support behind very progressive bills. So, for instance, same-sex union, anti-discrimination. And at the same time, he's also throwing support behind what we can call retrogressive bills, you know, lowering the age of criminal liability, you know, the death penalty. Can you, in like a minute, help us understand Speaker Alvarez?
Well, I cannot read Speaker Alvarez's mind. But, you know, many view the death penalty as a retrograde, no? Move or measure. But others would like to view it like as an extreme measure, like an extreme solution to an extreme problem. We have a saying in Spanish, grandes remedios para grandes problemas. Malaking remedio para sa malaking problema. It might sound radical, but... I try to listen to the pros and the cons. This is what we have been doing these past weeks in Congress with several interpellations. Ang sinasabi nga nila na maybe this is what the Philippines needs. Kasi sabi nila, ang ugali daw ng Pilipino by nature is pasaway. Kung walang isang drastic measure na ganito, ay patuloy pa rin susuway at gagawa ng krimen.
Have you made up your mind?
No, I have not yet made up my mind. I'm trying. It's a difficult balancing act because I am also the representative of the 1st District in Bataan. I am first and foremost the representative of the 1st District of Bataan. You know, and this is something basic, no? More basic than my other advocacies, no? And most of my constituents actually support the death penalty. Nagpa-survey po ako, 80-20. Para bang hujat to na taong bayan na isawa na sa walang nangyayari sa mabagal na pag-uusad ng ating justice system. And you know, as much as we would like to uphold the ideals of, you know, we want to be like other countries na humane na ganito dyan sa, in terms of itong capital punishment. Ang circumstances natin sa Pilipinas, iba eh. Parang sawang-sawa ng taong bayan.
Yeah. I think we'll need more time to discuss this, but
yes.
Let's go to
we have confession. 3 minutes left. This is gonna be quick. It's called The Good, The Bad, and The Maybe. I'm gonna give a current situation, and you can reply if it's a good idea or a bad idea. You can say maybe, which is your safe answer, but only one.
Okay, 10 to, ah.
Yes, 10. Okay, let's start. So the first one is Las Cañas surfacing to admit his involvement in the Davao Death Squad.
It's good.
Okay. Trump administration insisting on banning travelers from the 7 Muslim-majority countries from entering the U.S.
Bad.
A certain fast food company coming up with viral Valentine's commercials.
Good.
Malacañang telling the Communist Party of the Philippines to stop collecting revolutionary tax.
Good.
The Solicitor General saying that injustice was done to Napoles.
Bad.
Suspending field trips because of the deadly bus accident in Rizal.
Good.
Gina Lopez ordering closure of mines.
Good.
DOJ filing cases against Senator De Lima.
Navy.
AFE battalion joining war against illegal drugs.
Good.
Last one is Catholic Church opposing the death penalty bill.
As expected, good. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, we have 1 minute left.
Yes.
What I'm concerned about with the trial of Senator De Lima is this. Ito bang tamang court na maglilitis nitong kaso? Palagi ko po talaga yung ombudsman because yung mga accusations sa kanya ay happened supposedly during the time she was serving as Secretary of Justice. So, ang proper venue po niyan is the ombudsman.
All right.
Yun po yung aking sagot.
Unfortunately, that's all the time that we have. It's been a very provocative discussion. Sana nga we had more time. Unfortunately, we really have to end at 9:09. Magpaalam na tayo.
Thank you to everyone who watched us tonight. In case you didn't catch the first part or the middle part of the show, you can still watch us on Facebook Live on the Facebook page of Inquirer.net. And if you have other questions, just tweet us. And Kong Geraldine has a Twitter account as well. Yes. You
please
can send questions.
Me at Geraldine B. Roman. Roman. Geraldine B. Roman. Or meron din po akong sa Facebook if you're interested. I also want to encourage yung mga brothers and sisters of the LGBT community to reach out to me and tell me your stories dun sa FB account ko po. Mabuhay po kayong lahat. Maraming salamat po.
Okay. So who's next on the hot seat? Follow us on social media on Twitter at @JNary_Newsand and at @KSabilio_INQ.
Thank you very much, Kong Geraldine, and thank you to the different Inquirer audiences. This has been INQ&A. Thank you and good night.